And we close with new findings about declining lifespans for some women. Those come from a pair of new studies. The first reported that in 43% of the nation's counties, many of them in the South and the West, more women 75 and younger are dying sooner. The second study found mortality for all Americans under 50, but particularly women, is more pronounced in the U.S. than other high-income countries. Both were published in the journal Health Affairs. Editor-in-Chief and NewsHour regular Susan Dentzer joins me now. Susan, hello.
Nice to be with you, Gwen.
So the first question is why? Why are we seeing these increased mortality rates at younger ages?
This is an unfortunate stew of unpleasant circumstances. Chronic disease is driving a lot of this early death in women. A lot of this is death before the age of 50, believe it or not. So it's issues like obesity correlated with heart disease, diabetes, smoking. We know that 1 in 5 U.S. adults are still smoking. A lot of that smoking is going on in this population. Unintentional injuries, traffic accidents, and drug overdoses, particularly prescription drug abuse, emerging now in the data as another big cause of mortality in this population.
But at least in one of these studies, one was from the University of Wisconsin, one was from the University of Washington, at least in one, they said that male mortality figures were holding steady. Why aren't men more affected?
Well, it's been true over time that female life expectancy is generally longer than male life expectancy anyway. So it's not as if the situation is completely rosy for men. And it is true in the David Kindick's study from the University of Wisconsin that in 3% of U.S. counties, male mortality also is rising. So the men aren't held harmless here. But the big effect has been in women, and particularly since we've been expecting women's life expectancy to be longer, what we now see is that for women in particular with less than 12 years of education, so women who did not make it out of high school, their life expectancy has actually fallen by 4 years since 1990. And that means overall, it's part of the equation that now has U.S. life expectancy looking so poor relative to all our other rich countries, all peer countries.
Is there a regional way of pinpointing this or demographics?
Yes. If you look at a map, it's concentrated in, say, Kentucky, Tennessee, West Virginia, down to what's known as the Stroke Belt, Louisiana, Texas, over to the west. Not so much California, interestingly. And one interesting aspect of the story is that this is not a situation that's driven, it's not cropping up in the Hispanic population, for example. It's really more white, lower-income populations in the southern part of the country in particular.
And we say 43, that number 43% of county. What number? Is there a way to say how many women are actually affected?
Well, not necessarily from this study. But if you think about it, we have about 3,100 U.S. counties or parishes or the equivalent. And so it's a hefty portion. It's not the most populous counties. The more populous counties tend to be, say, in the Northeast or in California. These are less populous areas of the country that still are very, very hard hit by these phenomena.
And are there trend lines that we should be watching, whether it's comparing what's happening here to what's happening in other countries to just what's happening domestically?
Well, what we know is our situation continues to worsen relative to all the other rich countries. The Institute of Medicine published a study in January, U.S. Health and International Perspective, that shows that our life expectancy is worse, that our mortality before age 50 is particularly driving the problem. That was emphasized also by Jessica Ho's study. If you compare the years of life that Americans lose before the age of 50 relative to the average of all the other rich countries, we're double. We lose double the amount of life before age 50 of these other countries.
Is there a way to pinpoint when this slide began? Is this something that's brand new, or is this something that we've been able to document over time?
We've been seeing this crop up in the data starting in the late 80s and early 1990s. And one of the interesting factors that David Kindig, one of the authors, suggested is we really need to go back now and look at these data and see if they're correlated with any of our economic cataclysms that we've had.
Right.
Has that been driving any of this, or is this just independent of economic forces, independent of unemployment rates, for example? That could be a driver. We also know, of course, these are areas of the country where there's barely been any wage growth to speak of for many years, and we need to start to tease it across all of these economic and social factors that are driving this.
So there's an assumption somewhere in this that it's, if you dig deep enough, you may find that the reason why it happens in certain counties and not in others is that these people who maybe don't have the resources may be eating a worse diet, may be more likely to smoke, may engage in behaviors that you might not to if you're more prosperous.
And we know that these social and economic determinants of health, as they call it, are extremely powerful and usually are driving differences in health status, and it's most likely that that's the case here. What that means is that to tackle this is much more complicated than, for example, giving people access to health care. That really isn't going to be the fix. It will be efforts to raise educational levels, create more economic growth in communities, secure access to high-wage jobs, create a healthy food environment, more activity for individuals, all of those things, a much, much broader agenda.
How to turn it all around. Susan Dentzer of Health Affairs, thank you so much.
Great to be with you, Gwen.